The angel of the Lord declared unto Mary, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary.
Alleluia, alleluia.
Alleluia, alleluia.
Incline my heart, O God, to your decrees, and favor me with your law.
Alleluia, alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to
Matthew. Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus said to his disciples, "You have heard that it was said to your ancestors, 'Do not take a false oath, but make good to the Lord all that you have vowed.' But I say to you, do not swear at all, not by heaven, for it is God's throne, nor by the earth, for it is his footstool, nor by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. Do not swear by your head, for you cannot make a single hair white or black. Let your yes mean yes, and your no mean no. Anything more is from the evil one." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
A very wise spiritual director that I had right before I entered the order, he studied here at Yale, actually, Father Walter Wagner, who's a pastor now down at St. Ferrer in New York. But he told me that one of the temptations any of us have in living with others, whether with our own families or in religious life, is to treat the people around us like furniture. You kind of begin to take them as a given. You take the circumstances or the arrangement as a given. And then, depending on whether you like it or not, you can arrange in your mind how much rather you like it. Maybe in this period of quarantine and COVID, you're encountering furniture you'd like to throw away. But this is the thing, is it's a mentality that begins to take things for a given. And if this quarantine has disabused us of anything, it's to part ways with assuming that the way we plan things will go is the way they will actually go. To be ready to acknowledge things can be fairly or vastly different, I think, is not so much of a stretch for us now, and certainly less of a stretch for us now than it would have been 3 or 2 months ago. When you look at the life of St. Anthony, it's easy to see him as a given. You can call him St. Anthony in Padua, think of him as the greatest Italian saint, and invoke him to find lost articles. But if that's all you make for yourself on St. Anthony, you've kind of missed it. You've kind of made him a piece of furniture. If Father Jimmy Camacho were here, he would immediately chime in that he's actually St. Anthony of Lisboa, St. Anthony of Lisbon. Because St. Anthony wasn't Italian, he was Portuguese. And he, in this way, follows in a long line of saints that we assume are from one place that actually turn out to be from another. St. Anselm of Canterbury, Archbishop of the greatest diocese in England, was born in northern Italy, actually where my grandparents are from. St. Teresa of Calcutta is recounted for being this patron of Catholics of India, but most of you, I assume, know that she was born in Albania, or she was born in Macedonia, but of Albanian extraction. And of course, we know, I'm sorry to say at this time it might not go over well, that St. Joseph was not actually Italian. He was a Jew born in Palestine. All of these things are worth keeping in mind because we have to move away from treating the saints as furniture, as seeing their final destination, in a sense, as the last word. Because St. Anthony wasn't originally a Franciscan. As natural as it might seem to see him in a habit and difficult to imagine him apart from it, he was originally an Augustinian canon. And his life changed drastically. He was ready to see his life change drastically when he heard about the 5 Franciscan martyrs who had gone down to North Africa seeking to convert the Saracens. And understandably, they put them to death. That was a recipe for good order in their society. But he saw it rightly as a call to a more radical sanctity. That while he had sought out religious life, he had sought out the common life as a place to grow in holiness, he had realized that there was a place where that could be followed even more ardently. And so he changed his circumstances. He recognized that things were not as much of a given, and he moved to becoming a Franciscan. He wanted to go to North Africa to do the very same thing they did, hopefully with different results, because ultimately, the desire for martyrdom is the fool's errand simply for your own death. It's to win the conversion and the elevation of others, the glory of God. But illness prevented him from lasting there for any length of time. And so he settled in Italy, where he was well received, as any of us know. So again, when we think of this year, where one circumstance changes after another, we can look to St. Anthony as a patron of thwarted plans, of changed circumstances, and see how he was able to find, in the midst of a career, if I dare put it that way, in the midst of a vocation that was to a large degree improvised, he found an incredible holiness, such that he was canonized within 9 months of his death, because the works that he was able to work, the preaching and the signs that accompanied it, were proof to people that his life resonated with the fullness of the gospel. The most striking image, I think, of this improvised understanding of Anthony's life was when he joined a group of friars who assembled Franciscans and Dominicans. Many of you may know this story, where he was slated for a Dominican to preach on this particular feast, and for whatever reason, possibly because the Franciscans are exaggerating the fact and recounting the story, but the Dominicans were not ready to preach. Now, maybe that's less of a stretch for you who are ministry from Dominican friars. You see various times where Dominicans aren't ready to preach. And sometimes I'm sure I'm there, and I'm the only Dominican there. But suffice it to say, the story is that Anthony was called up without any preparation to preach for the congregation of assembled friars. And he preached with simplicity and a resonance that they had not expected. They thought of him as, you know, a decent friar, someone who would do the work of workers, not a particularly good preacher. But he showed them at that time a single focus in solidarity. Wisdom is one. It comes from God, who is one. And wisdom allows us to unite all things, to choose our words well, to weigh them effectively, and to use them in a way that works for the congregation who hears that wisdom. It involves picking the right words. It involves meaning that your yes means yes, and your no means no, and that anything else, any attempt to muddle what you might have to say, is a derogation, it's a moving away from the fullness of wisdom. And so Anthony spoke with that simplicity of purpose, that simplicity of purpose that drove him to Franciscan life in the first place, that simplicity and ardent desire to live out the fullness of the gospel the way that St. Francis had come to understand. That is the root that enables him and any of us to be flexible in the face of changing circumstances. That wisdom, who is one, namely Christ, enables us in any situation to be apt to purpose. Now, depending on your personality or gifts or challenges, there will be times where that's more difficult than others. But look to St. Anthony as an example of what it means to be graceful in improvisation. What it means to be firm and rooted when you might appear to be lost. And don't be afraid to invoke him not only when you've lost your keys, but when you've lost your sense of the day or your sense of purpose in a wider sense. Because he navigated the very same streams and waters that we all navigate. He's had years and appointments canceled and upended in front of him as we have. And for all of it, we have this furniture, right, this column in the church of St. Anthony, who stands as a witness then for the rest of us to build with. But let us not take him for granted. Let us not recognize how different it could have been for him, and by extension, how different it's meant to be for us. sacrifice and yours may be accepted for the vow of the altar. As we celebrate the divine mysteries, O Lord, we pray, may the Holy Spirit fill us with the light of faith, by which He constantly enlighten the blessed and the spread of your glory, through Christ our Lord. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you, for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory." The mystery of faith. We proclaim
the resurrection.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you the thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Both we pray upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim life whose death is able to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body and one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, your spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with our Holy Father, St. Dominic, with St. Anthony of Padua, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for our faith. May the sacrifice of our reconciliation advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope and Letter, our Bishop, the Order of Bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people who have gained for your mind. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned to be true. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kindly presence to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom we bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command,
I'm going to go to the hospital.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who call to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter
into my
room,
but only say the words, and my soul shall be healed. The body of Christ.
We proclaim Christ crucified, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. Let us pray. Refreshed by heavenly food and the important Lord, that attending to the teaching of Blessed Anthony, we may abide all times in thanksgiving for the gifts we have received through Christ our Lord. One brief announcement, which is basically a request for anyone who might be able to stay behind after Mass to help us clean and sanitize the church. Part of the requirements for us to be able to operate in the manner we can now, thanks be to God, is that we have to sanitize every surface here that might have been in contact with someone who might have had the coronavirus. So, again, this is only for people who aren't at risk, and it's not for me to assume who is at risk or not, but generally that's people who are under 60 and who are in good health, or, you know, it wouldn't be catastrophic, odds are, if they were to have get the virus. So if some of those folks could stop in the sacristy after, we have spray bottles and cloths and all that fun stuff. So also if you're a little neurotic, I'd like to clean this community. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace.
Thank you, God.
Saint Michael.